Today we're going to be talking about Submachine Universe, the final Flash version that was released just over a year ago on December 20th, 2017. And I put off talking about it because around that time I was getting frustrated with the plot and lore and connections of the main Submachine storyline, so I decided to table the whole universe for a while, and then I got involved in other things. But now I'm back to talk about Submachine Universe because this game has been in development since 2010, so it's been 8 years in the making, of which I've been able to observe about four of those. And the next time we see it, when it's released on Steam and redone in Game Maker, it's going to be very different, so I figured, you know, may as well share some thoughts on it right now while I can. While it's still fresh in my head, I just replayed it in its entirety a couple days ago. Submachine Universe is a really... It's not a game. It never was a game, according to the developer, Matosh Skutnik. And even though it has an official ending now, spoilers if you haven't played it already. Yeah, by the way, if you haven't played this most recent version, go to matoshskutnik.itch.io, download it, it's free. Basically stop the video right here before we get too far into this, and go play it. If you like Submachine, if you like Room Escape, go back, revisit this game. Maybe you played it a couple of years ago, and it's changed a lot since then, and I'll be talking about those changes in this video and sort of what I think about them. This game has turned out to be what I'll describe as a very beautiful and heartfelt mess. It's not a bad mess by any means. Well, I mean, the reason I say that is the game is known for sort of being what I would consider a love letter from Matosh to the fans and the work that a lot of the fans do as far as trying to kind of pick apart the little things that make Submachine Universe so mysterious to a lot of people. A lot of this takes the form of theories, quote-unquote theories, which are notes that are left in all of these different locations that you explore, written by actual fan members, which makes them special, and they've been sort of adapted into these notes that have been left around by maybe some explorers or something like that. But Matt has made it very clear throughout the years that these notes are not canon stuff. The locations evidently are canon stuff, but all these notes that you find are not canon stuff. So this game is this mishmash of canon stuff and non-canon stuff, which has pretty much gone on the down low for people who really care about the canon versus non-canon nature for a while, and everybody's just pretty much sort of accepted it. One thing interesting to note is that a lot of, well, I guess not a lot, but some of the locations, if you pay close attention, like you drop into a certain coordinate and then you read the theory in there, and then you actually look around and see how the location is structured, you'll notice that it actually reflects a lot of the stuff that you'll hear in the notes, which is sort of interesting. So it actually makes the environment sort of tied to whatever was going on inside that person's head. Probably intentional design. Now, the reason I bring up the theories is because, again, it's really made this game special, and the theories are going to be taken out in this next version of Submachine Universe that we see redone in Game Maker and released on Steam probably somewhere in the early 2020s, so we have a couple of years to think about it and wait for that to come out. The game is going to look radically different whenever it's released, according to the developer. All of the fan stuff is going to be wiped away. All of the stuff that really came from anybody besides Matosh Skutnik is going to be wiped away. It's going to get the full FLF treatment, times a thousand in this case, because this game is really big. And it'll be all original Submachine canon material. And I look forward to that. It'll be kind of sad to see it, to see like all of the personal stuff that people have worked on, including my own stuff that is contributed to the Submachine universe, be deleted in a sense and probably replaced with other stuff. But I imagine that the Flash version will be kept around for other people to play for a long time. It's just, you can't make money off of it if it's not your own stuff and it's a lot of other people's IP. So it makes too much sense to take that stuff out, and I fully support that, and I'd really be interested to see what Matt comes up with in place of that stuff. I don't know if there are some locations, like I said, some locations are sort of modeled after the theories. I don't know if they're going to be changed as well, and kind of see what that does for what makes up an official location in this universe. but I guess we'll just have to see. So I've been with this game for 4 years, and probably one of the things that I've enjoyed most about it is just letting go of all of, or most of, the sort of sense of like trying to figure out what the giant overarching picture is as far as the chain of events of stuff that goes on, the lore, all of that stuff. It kind of melts away a lot easier in this game than it does with the main series or the side games like Ancient Adventure FLF 32 Chambers. Because this one is more just about going through the locations, finding those clue plates of other locations that are just scattered everywhere eventually. It doesn't actually make a lot of real-world logical sense when you think about it, but then again, when has a room escape game ever really made sense as far as its puzzles when applied to a real-life standard? Not a lot of games really do that. Some games get around it by just basically telling you what the premise is up front and just being like, oh yeah, this is a nice little game. Like, the Room Escape games by Neutral XE, really well done 3D graphics, and they're basically just like, yeah, this room is just a big ass puzzle, solve it. Each one takes place in a different environment, so yeah, some games get around it. I think the more renowned Room Escape game series, like Submachine, Cube Escape, whatsoever, kinda have to work a little bit on that, but it's not really a big deal. And one of the things that's been really interesting about the Submachine series, because it's been going on for 8 years, is the fact that you get to see the new locations sort of evolve throughout this time. The game has this really unique feature. It's almost like sort of a metagame in a sense, or not even a metagame, but it's like you keep coming back to it every few months, or at least for the period of time it was every few months or every half year or so, and there would be a new update, and there would be all these different locations in places that you didn't see before. Like, you would go to this one location and be like, oh yeah, there's a wall here, there's nowhere else to go in the years past. But now when you go to this location after you hear about the latest update and you're so excited to download it or play it for the first time, or the new update for the first time, and you go and you see, oh, this location has changed. What I am used to has been all of a sudden sort of jolted around and risen from the ground, and it's all up in the air. And that brief moment that you get, and this was, I've talked with a couple other fans of the games, and they really appreciate that moment as well, because it contributes to this other sense of the universe growing in a way. And it's sort of sad in a sense, because I don't know if something like that is ever going to be possibly achieved with this game ever again. When it goes to Steam, I don't know how you're going to get that sort of sense of revisiting a location that you once thought you knew the entire layout to, only to see it changed and be tossed into uncertain waters for a while. That's sort of, I feel, going to become a relic to the past. If there was a way to sort of implement that in a nicely wrapped up version of this game, I don't know how the developer would be able to pull that off, but I think that was one of the things that made it really special for me, to see this game physically grow in file size from year to year, or from month to month even. It was one of the things that really made it unique, and one of the things that kept making me gravitate back toward it. And along with just having the physical locations expand and lead to other locations, you get this really cool effect of seeing how Matt's art style has changed throughout the years. It's slowly become more and more complex over the 12 plus years that he's been working on the Submachine series. So you'll see some rooms that are really simple, and they also take not as long to load. That's one of the problems with Flash, is that it has those graphics limitations that I don't really understand. But with the newer rooms that are more detailed, unfortunately, it's really hard to play them in full screen unless you have a really good computer. The playthrough that I recorded, just for my own personal use, like, I had to force it to low quality just because whatever happened, like, the Flash version did not agree with my computer. That's another reason why I'm looking forward to Game Maker, because evidently all that stuff is just going to go away and we're going to have, like, perfect graphics, 60 frames per second. The little tests that Matt has released, if that's any way indicative of what the future games are going to look like, then it's going to be great. It's going to surpass far anything that I've played before as far as the Submachine versions. And I'm really looking forward to it. But yeah, you get to see his art style change and evolve and get more and more complex over the years as well. There's a huge temporal aspect to this, like a real-world temporal aspect to this game that really makes it unique. And if you're around for it, I think you'll be able to understand immediately how unique that is. And I really hope that you guys hold on to it for future years to talk about with your grandchildren. One of the problems that I do think that this game might run into if there are any sort of precedents being set by this is the fact that the game does contain lore to the Submachine series. And I haven't really explained in great detail why I have such a problem with the way that the story and plot is presented in these games. I had the episode of BTM7 where I basically just did a full-out rant as to what exactly I thought was wrong with it, but even that video I don't feel has really satisfied it that much, and that is a video that I would probably like to revisit in the future. But no promises being made there. But this game does push the lore in some spots. And the thing with this game, this there's something nagging at the back of my head that I feel like Matt is going to do. Like some people would say it's a stunt that Matt is going to pull. I want you to think about when Submachine Future Loop Foundation, the original version, was remade. And what happened in that game was that that game was originally made to be a promo sort of game for this band called Future Loop Foundation. And so therefore it had like pictures of the album covers in the game itself. It was really cool. And it had the music of the band itself. It had the two tracks that everybody knows and loves who's familiar with the Submachine games, Stereo 72 and I don't remember the other one on top of my head right now, but it'll come to me later. That stuff was taken out because Matt decided to make it all his stuff, all basically Matosh and Thumpmunks with the music, and fully canonize it as part of the Submachine universe. But what he did upon release of this second version is he, rather than sort of ditching the first version of the game or overwriting it to the sense where we didn't have to worry about it as much as far as canonized versions, he instead started referring to the second version of this game, the fully Matosh X Thumpmunks version, as the Layer 5 version of the original game. Which basically, if I'm reading Matosh correctly, which is harder to do than some people might think, he's basically keeping both versions canon. One version happens in one layer. If you're familiar with the Submachine games, you know about the layer structure, or at least a concept of it. And then the new version of the game is in the fifth layer. So they're both canon and both in different realities. And honestly, I think it would have just been so much simpler to just take the first game and be like, okay, you know what? That's not canon anymore. Play it for fun. If you want to figure out the lore and plot and stuff, don't worry about the first game. But instead, he decides to sort of keep both with this language. Again, this is taking him at his word and assuming that he's serious. And I hope for all of those who will try to study this game series and the chain of events and stuff in the future that he does not do the same thing and he does not pull the same sort of stunt with this Submachine universe on Steam. I can so easily picture him being like, oh, well, you know, this game is like what we had before when it was in Flash, but now everything is slightly different than what you knew before. In fact, it's just in a different layer. But then again, like, he throws this phrase around a lot. If you go on his Twitter, if you basically follow him on anything, you'll see posts where he's like, meanwhile, in another layer, and then he goes off and he talks about something that he's doing in Revolucha, or whatever, however you pronounce that, the Revolutions comics that he does. So it's like, oh, is this all part of the same universe, just in a different layer, just in a different reality? Am I just throwing stuff around to make references to my own games to be funny? Or is there a giant interconnected universe at work here that you have no chance of solving, but I want you guys to consider it anyway, sort of thing? We don't really know. I hope that it ends up being, you know what, keep the Flash version, you guys had fun with that, you get to be represented as fans, but now we're gonna actually get into the real thing. This is what you guys should focus on when it comes to tearing apart those games. Because the culture does exist, obviously, for picking apart games, as everybody else knows. It might not be the majority of the fan base, but it still is a part of the fan base that is attracted to that sort of stuff. So I hope things do not get more complicated than they already are in the future. And maybe I'll explore that whole thing, that whole overarching concept with the Submachine plot and the holes that I perceive in the future. That's basically all that I have to say about this game. It's a beautiful mess, and that's about it. I'm done. Submachine Universe, Flash version, good-ass game. I hope that we will see a lot more in the future. Bye-bye.